So welcome everyone, students, faculty, staff, administrators. This is the opening of the Breaking Barriers lecture series. This series was really devoted to help our campus advance in regards to educational equity. We're bringing speakers that are nationally recognized to speak to students, faculty, staff, and administrators about pivotal equity-related issues that we need to be aware of to best work with our students, to best help us decrease and eventually hopefully eliminate the equity gaps that are not only here at College of Alameda, but persistent across institutions of higher education. So today, we're getting started with Dr. Jeff Duncan-Andrade. Okay, so let me give you an introduction to who is Dr. Jeff Duncan-Andrade. As you can see up on the screen, his official title, he's an associate professor at San Francisco State University out of the Raza Studies Department. But this man goes way above and beyond just being a professor. He's currently in the process of opening a new school called Growing Roses in Concrete. He's directed organizations in the past. He has a part also of another organization called ISEEED. He speaks nationally as well as internationally. He's well recognized within the field of education, and this is somebody that we all can learn from immensely. So without further ado, here's Dr. Jeff Duncan-Andrade.
So it's always good to talk about the work locally with folks who are on the ground with us in the East Bay generally, but you know my heart and my head rest every evening in East Oakland, so that's, and hopefully there's some East Oakland folks in the house today. So the talk that I'm gonna do today is actually based on an article that I wrote for the Harvard Ed Review a few years back. So if there's stuff that comes up for you today that you wanna, that resonates with you at any level, that you wanna do a deeper dive on, you can Google search my name and the title of this talk. It's the same, that's the same title that I used for the article. And you can almost certainly pull down a PDF of it online and check out whatever resources that I'm dropping in the talk today that you find useful. For any reason, you can't dig it up online, then feel free to email me right here. And I'll be happy to violate my publishing contract with Harvard and send it to you. So I'm the youngest of seven kids. And as the youngest, I often felt like it was my birthright to complain about pretty much everything. And I remember one time I come in the house and I'm ranting and raving about something. And my mom stops me in the middle of my rant. And she points at the kitchen table and she says, "Sit down." And she goes in the kitchen and she takes a glass and she fills it halfway with water and she comes back and puts the glass down on the table and sits down. And she points at the glass and says to me, "Half full or half empty?" And my mom's was good for those kind of trick questions where there is no right answer, so whatever answer you give is the wrong answer, and that's the lesson that she needs to give you right now. So I just kind of stared back blankly. I didn't take the bait. She says, "Son, how you choose to answer that question is how you will live your life. Because your life will always be both half full and half empty. And if you choose to see your life as half empty, if you choose to see your life for all the things that you don't have, you will never fill your cup. But if you can see your life as half full, if you can see your life for the things that you do have, you will fill your cup, it will overflow, and you can share that with others." Now, this is precisely what I think that Tupac Shakur means when he talks about young people growing up in poverty as the roses that grow from concrete. You come down wherever you want on pop. Cornel West says, "No one free of spot or wrinkle." And I agree. I think Pac deserves to be critiqued for some of the things that he did and some of the things that he said and some of the ways that he lived his life, but who doesn't? And what is undeniable to me, as someone that has taught in my community in East Oakland, high school mostly, started in middle school, for 22 years, as a father of two sons that are being raised on a 3400 block of East Oakland, as a community member on the 3400 block of East Oakland, and as a researcher. I challenge you to find anyone in late modernity that has had the reach to teach that Tupac Shakur has. And Pac was murdered in 96. Okay? And cats are still bumping Pac. Most folks in this audience right here have at least one Pac song that is a regular part of their playlist. That includes the professors here. Don't slip on the professors. Cats from way back still be bumping Pac. I work with elementary school youth. Okay? Still listen to Pac. Alright, so it's not hip-hop. If it was hip-hop, cats would still be bumping Wu-Tang. Cats would still be bumping Public Enemy. Cats would still be bumping Chris. Okay? But they're not. Hip-hop heads are, but everyday folks aren't. Right? So it's not hip-hop. It's something about Pac's message that has transcended time. Right, that continues to resonate across all the lines that we say we want to cross as educators, across race, across class, across gender, across political boundaries. You go to Lily White Suburbs, you go to Piedmont. Them cats is listening to Pac. Okay? So as a father, as an educator, as a researcher, as a community member, I wanted to understand, what is it about Pac's message that has been so transcendent? And how do I distill that out and make that a part of my everyday teaching to the high school youth that I work with in East Oakland? And so as a way to frame up what that is, and let me just say, okay, as a I teach high school English, okay, most recently at Fremont High, which is my neighborhood high school in the East. And I can tell you as a high school English teacher, I can take a crisp $100 bill and stick it inside of any Shakespearean text. And leave that text anywhere in my classroom and it is completely safe. But if I leave Pac's book of poetry out, anywhere in my, a lot of folks don't know Pac published a book of poetry. Okay, so Pac wrote a book of poetry, that's actually the title of his book of poetry, it's actually the title of probably his best known poem. If I leave that book out anywhere in my classroom, it is immediately snatched up by the very same young people that the system is convinced are not interested in literacy. What I tell principals, what I tell superintendents, what I tell teachers, what I told Arnie Duncan, is that it's not that young people aren't interested in literacy. It's that they're not interested in the literacy we're giving them. Okay? Those are two different issues. When you see the problem as young people just don't want to read, okay, then the problem rests with the young people. But when you see that young people don't want to read what we give them, then the problem actually rests with the adults. And we're the ones that got to start shifting. We got to stop putting all the burden on young people and start looking in the mirror and looking at what is wrong with our institutions when we are not able to engage huge percentages of our young people any longer in school. And so for me, Pac is a starting point around that, to try to understand that more deeply. Right now, as a way to frame up this conversation that I want to have today, I'm going to actually play Pac reading this poem. And now Pac actually, and now Powerade done messed it up for me because they got, at least they did D. Rose in the commercial. But Pac actually read the poem on multiple tracks. The one that is probably the best known is a song called Mama's Just a Little Girl. Okay, and at the end of that song, Pac reads this poem over the beat of the song. So I'm gonna play that as a way to frame up the conversation that I'd like to have today.
Ask us why we're turning from bad to worse. It's to ignore from which we came. Mama's just a little singer when asked why the roads that grew from the concrete had damaged petals. On the contrary, we would all celebrate its tenacity. We would all love its will to reach the sun. Well, we are the roses. This is the concrete. And these are my damaged petals. These are my damaged. Don't ask me why. Don't ask me. Thank God. Thank God. Ask me how.
Now, Pac's message in this poem, to me, is precisely the same message that my mother was giving to me at that kitchen table. What Pac points out is how absurd it would be for you and the homie to be walking down the street, and you see a rose in the concrete, and you turn to the homie like, a rose in the concrete. And the homie looks back and says, yeah, but what a shame. It has damaged pedals. Of course it has damaged pedals, fool. It's going in the concrete. But we do this all the time with young people. We see them for their damaged pedals instead of for their tenacity and their will to reach the sun. We see them as glasses half empty instead of glasses half full. They are both. Every person in this room is a glass half empty and a glass half full. And truth be told, when someone sees you as a glass half empty, when someone sees you for what you can't do, you do not bust your ass to spend time with that person. In fact, what you do is you watch the clock. As long as I have to be here, I will be here, and I'm gonna push on. And I'm gonna go push to willingly be around people who see me as a glass half full. That's our choice as educators. We choose how we see these babies that come to us. And when we see them as a glass half empty, they never fill up. When we see them for their damaged pedals, they never fill up. But when we see them as a glass half full, when we see them for their tenacity and their will to reach the sun, those are the teachers that students will go above and beyond for. Those are the teachers that students run to class to get on time. They stay late. They come after school. They come on the weekends. They go above and beyond. The assignment has nothing to do with the student. It has to do with the adult's relationship to the student. That has a massive impact on how students respond to instruction in the classroom. That's our choice. So we gotta stop putting that onus back on students first. We are so quick to give the people with the least amount of power the most responsibility. Yeah. And the people with the most power have the least responsibility in the relationship. That is backwards. And this is why so many young people reject school. It's not because they don't wanna learn. It's because school is ass backwards. And when we get school right side up, my experience has been that students come running to that because young people want to learn. What they don't want is bullshit. They want to learn the truth. They want to learn things that are actually going to help them in their life right now. And the truth is that we don't develop school practices that are truly responsive to young people's damaged pedals. I have damaged pedals. I wear them in ink on my arms. So that every morning when I get out the shower and I look in the mirror, I'm reminded of who I am and where I come from. But you see, schools told me that that ink was my problem. Schools told me that I would be worth so much more. I'd be so much easier to teach. I'd have such an easier time in this society, in this economy, if I could just take that ink away. If I could just leave it at the door and come in and pretend that everything was all right. But you see, the truth about the ink is it don't come off. The ink's on my arm forever. And the reason that Pac resonated with me is because Pac said, I see you. I see that ink. And what I see from that ink is your tenacity and your will to reach the sun. It is your damaged pedals that make you great. But that's not how we respond in school. That's not how schools responded to me. And until we flip that paradigm and are willing to really see the ink that young people bring with them as their value, as their strength, then the young people that wear ink on their arms will continue to struggle to connect to what school's offering them. Now, if we're gonna do that, then we better understand the ink a hell of a lot better. Of all the stuff I've read, all the experts I've met with, all the lectures I've been to, nothing has more profoundly impacted my day-to-day work with young people than this film series. It is a 6-part film series from PBS called Unnatural Causes. It is a global study of this question: is inequality making us sick?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Widely agreed upon across fields, social epidemiology, public health, neuroscience, the medical field, all agree. The biggest threat to health on the planet is inequality. So College of Alameda, if you run in your mouth about having a healthy school community, if you are running your mouth about having healthy classroom environments, let me just tell you what the research says. The research says the biggest threat to that project is inequality. So if you have inequality on this campus, then you are just running your mouth about having a healthy community. If you do not have all forms of inequality on the table all the time, you cannot have a healthy community. Okay, so just be clear about that, that it's not about having a campus health center. When do you need a campus health center? When you're already sick. Sickness is the absence of health. Okay? Health, okay, is preventative. The pursuit of a healthy community is about preventing people from ever getting sick. I'm not saying you shouldn't have a health center. That's dull. You should have that. Okay? Because cats will get sick, and the health center should be able to help them out. Right? But the goal, okay, is to create a community that never needs to go to the health center, because the broader community is so nurturing and healthy. And the only way to do that is to completely eradicate inequality. This is not theory, this is not my idea. This is what the leading health researchers in the world are saying. Now, if you're gonna do that, then you're gonna have to pay attention to these things and many, many more. As Pott points out, the concrete is thick, it's multi-layered, it is complex. And when you think about it, concrete is perhaps the worst environment in which something can attempt to grow. Is devoid of light, is devoid of key nutrients, and on top of all that, the concrete is toxic. Now, what I can't tell you, because I ain't from Alameda, okay, so I don't even really know, Alameda frankly scares me, I don't even like coming through that tunnel. I feel less safe over here than I do over there. But, so I can't tell you, you know, I do this talk all over the world, and what I say is, I can't tell you, this is not in an order of priority or importance. Okay? Every community has to do its own work. Right? So you need to figure out, based on the community that you're really trying to serve, is which of these is at the top? Which of these do you have to start with? And so what I tell educators all over the world is, first and foremost, you must become an ethnographer of your community. You must become an ethnographer of the young people that you serve. What is actually going on in their lives, in their communities, before they ever step foot in your classroom? And then you can prioritize these based on whatever it is that your students are experiencing most. Right? What I can tell you with a high level of certainty is where we need to start in my community. And that's with violence. Okay? Y'all know, I mean, you on the other side of the tunnel, some of you come through the tunnel just like me to get to Alameda every day. Okay? So you know, right, that we dealing with a lot over there. In 2006, the San Francisco Chronicle called itself so concerned with homicide, they started mapping it. And they said that we had the plague, which I find interesting because, as I told y'all at the beginning of the talk, I live in the 3400 block. I live right about, oh shit, this thing ain't working. I live right about there. And as you can see, our plague has been almost perfectly quarantined between the 580 and the 880 freeways, what we call the flatlands or the lower bottoms. And you don't gotta be a topographical genius, okay, looking at this map to see the outlier. Now, what I find interesting about them saying we have the plague is, if we have the plague, everybody in here who's really from Alameda, okay, and I'm looking around, it doesn't look like very many folks is actually really from Alameda. Okay? We still at the College of Alameda. So anybody here who's actually from Alameda, y'all would be in trouble. Because the funny thing about the plague is, it's the ultimate non-discriminator, isn't it? The plague doesn't recognize race, it doesn't recognize class, it doesn't recognize gender, and it sure as hell doesn't recognize political boundaries, but those red lines just popped up by the political boundaries of our city. And so this is, Oakland doesn't have a plague. This particular quarantine region of Oakland has the plague. What we call the flatlands of the lower bottoms. And if you look at this map, you ain't got to be a topographical genius to see the outlier. What is it? I mentioned them earlier. Piedmont. Hey, now what the hell is going on in Piedmont where they can completely opt out of the plague? Just be like, nah, I'm cool. I don't want none. Cornel West jokes that the Disneyland brags, nobody's ever died on that premises. He says, somebody probably has. They just push them across the line to keep their record clean. I think that's exactly what happened right there. That shit was probably in Piedmont. They're like, oh, no, I'm going to give that back to Oakland. Just get his arm back across the line. Oakland won't care if they get one more. 5 years, we had 555 homicides. 2007, the Chronicle gives up, and the Oakland Tribune starts mapping homicides in our community. And so now every year, they put up the homicide map on the front page of the Oakland Tribune once a year. These are four of the most recent maps, and as you can see, there's been no stemming of the tide. And so I decided that I would update the homicide map. And I'm going to do that for 13 years. Because that's how many years a young person is actually in school before they come to College of Alameda. This is 9 years, y'all. This kid is just coming to my ninth grade freshman English class at Fremont High. And you tell me, where can he live, where can she live, where they have not personally witnessed homicide, if not multiple homicides? And yet, what's the conversation in school about? Common Core, No Child Left Behind, A through G, Casey, rigor. Don't you want to go to college? All of which matter. All of which are a morally suspect position to start with when you know that's what's happening in the community. And you're going to talk to me about my chemistry homework before we talk about that? You're going to talk to me about my essay and we're not connecting my essay to me healing from that? Well, at the same time, you're talking down to the other side and now saying you care about me and this is family and we're here for you? Mm-mm. Mm-mm. This is why so many young people reject school. Because school is upholding a morally suspect position inside of this reality. And until we are willing to address that, until schools are willing to address what's actually happening in the neighborhoods and the communities, then schools are a joke. Schools are just a bunch of folks up there running their mouth about how much they care while not really dealing with the stuff that is most pressing in our lives. And the reason this matters so much is because exposure to this kind of trauma causes PTSD. And let me just be clear with y'all, because I knew this talk all over and folks were like, well, I sure am glad we don't have homicides like you have in Oakland. And I said, well, me too. But guess what? It's not just homicides that cause PTSD. It's that whole list. So being entrenched in poverty causes trauma. Okay? Having insecure, unstable housing causes trauma. Having a lack of access to healthy food causes trauma. Domestic violence causes trauma. Drug abuse causes trauma. Spiritual destruction causes trauma. Being taught to hate yourself for the color of your skin, the texture of your hair, your body image, the language that you speak, the country that your family comes from, causes trauma. And the problem with the conversation about trauma, thank you, is that it's mostly focused on this dude, which is right because soldiers are particularly prone to PTSD. But nobody's talking about these brothers. These are my students. This is us burying another one of my students. A 16-year-old stabbed more than a dozen times in the face with a screwdriver about 3 blocks from my house. And this is who buried him. And the next day, we back at the schoolhouse. And what's the schoolhouse talking about? No Child Left Behind. A through G, Casey scores, credits, none of which I'm saying don't matter. You can do your own diligence on me. You can see what happens with the young people I work and how many of them go on to college and how many of them graduate. That's not the question. That shit's easy. The question is how? How do we get 90% of the kids that we're working with in deep East Oakland to go on to a UC or a CSU? It's not because we focus on fucking Casey. It's because we focus on this. We focus on their humanity. We don't just say we love them. We get to the work of actually loving them. And if you're going to love somebody, you're going to have to deal with this. If that's what they're going through. But most folks don't want to touch that. Because that shit hurts. You're going to have to deal with some rage and some real pain if you're going to deal with trauma. And it's so much easier to just roll out the fucking textbook and give you some worksheets and tell you to bubble that shit in. And then I run it through a Scantron. And I ain't never got to deal with your humanity. I ain't never got to deal with your cousin on the corner. I ain't never got to deal with your mama. And then 50, 60, 70% of y'all going to leave school. Why? Because fuck school if it's not dealing with that. Because that's what's on my mind right now. That's the challenge. Can schools meet the challenge? The question isn't whether or not young people can meet the challenge. They meet the damn challenge because they get to school every day. The question is whether or not the grown folks in the institutions that's making all this money off of us is actually going to address what we really need from them. That's the question. That's the open question. That's the open question. I'm saying, Barack Obama, why are you still silent on this? Why are you still silent on Ferguson? You fucking black man! Watching young black men get gunned down in the streets and you better release a press statement? This is the challenge. The young people are looking to us as the adults to meet. And as long as we don't meet it, why would they follow us? Why would they listen to what we are talking about when that's what they got to deal with every day and we don't want to touch it? Of all the stuff I've read, here's a great starting point. And I'm talking to young people in here too. If you've been through some shit, like I've been through, when I read this book, man, it was big. It was big because I came up and I thought something was wrong with me. You understand? I was told all the time that I got anger problems. Right? I shit you not, I had a chair named after me in my elementary school principal's office. It was my chair. I was there so much. She just made a chair for me. When I read this book, okay, because this book is by a dude named Bruce Perry. Bruce Perry is considered the nation's leading expert on child trauma. And every chapter in this book is about a young person or a group of young people that he's worked with that have experienced high levels of trauma. Some of it is homicide, some of it is abuse, some of it is neglect, okay, all kinds of different stuff. When I read this book, okay, I wept. I literally wept twice. I wept once for all the harm I've done. I realized every time I read one of these chapters, I seen one of my students, because he talks about how trauma manifests in the lives of young people who don't have the language to describe what they're experiencing. And then so we say, well, it's bad behavior. No, it's pain. It's unaddressed pain. And I saw some of my students that I've worked with over the 20 years, and I knew what they were going through. I knew what they were going through. And I came up short. And so I added to their trauma because I couldn't meet them where they were. And that shit hurts. So if you're an educator in this room and you're really going to do this work, be prepared to hurt. Be prepared to confront your own failures and your own pain. Stop focusing on what young people don't have and turn that lens internally, okay, to us really dealing with where we're coming up short. The second reason I cried when I read this book is because I realized that there wasn't anything wrong with me. That I didn't have ADD. I didn't have ADHD. I didn't have anger management problems. What I had was trauma. And what my body was doing, that rage that got me locked up, that rage that had me out in the streets every night sneaking out of the house, that unaddressed pain was actually normal. It was actually my biological imperative to operate in that way. It was my body's way of trying to respond to the pain. And so it was liberating for me. It will be liberating for you to understand why your body is reacting in that way. Why sometimes you are just so fucking tired. Part of it might be because you stayed up till 4 a.m. talking to that person you're trying to get at. Okay, well, that's a personal problem. Okay? You can deal with that on your own, right? But sometimes you be having a full night's sleep and you wake up and you just tired. You can't even get out of bed. You feel unmotivated. That's trauma. And if you understand that, if you understand why your body's reacting in that way. And you'll stop blaming yourself. You'll stop thinking that you aren't good enough. You'll understand why your body's behaving in that way. And then you can get on the path of actually healing, where you start having more and more energy. So that's a great starting point. If you're going to read any book on trauma, that's where I would start. Now, the funny thing to me about schools is they're always talking about they're going to be data-driven. Maybe data-driven. Okay? All right, cool. I think we should be data-driven. Problem is, we look at all the wrong data. And when you look at the wrong data, you come up with the wrong pathways. So we work with schools to rethink the data you're looking at. So let's start here. Here's some data. All right, this is from the national data set on trauma. 1 in 3 urban youth display the symptoms of mild to severe PTSD. 1 in 3. When they compared that to the Pentagon's data for soldiers returning from live combat, Iraq, Afghanistan, what they found is that urban youth are actually twice as likely as a soldier returning from combat to have PTSD. Twice as likely. The Veterans Administration that works with soldiers says that PTSD is perhaps the most pressing medical issue that they are facing as an organization nationally. It is their number one health issue. And they are half as likely as schools to have to deal with trauma. And I have yet to come across a school that has said that trauma is a top issue for us, let alone the top issue, even though all the data suggests that it will be, inevitably, be a major issue. And there's no conversation in schools about this. What's even more interesting is that in 2011, Harvard School of Public Health said, actually, young people don't have PTSD. Because PTSD stands for what? Post-traumatic, which makes sense for a soldier because the soldier leaves the battlefield, but what about young people? Right, they're going back into it over and over and over again. And so, in 2011, Harvard School of Public Health released an entirely new diagnosis called CPTSD, which stands for complex PTSD. Because what they're seeing in the brains and the bodies of young people that are exposed to toxic stress over and over and over again is even more complex than what they see in soldiers. We haven't figured it out with soldiers. And it's more complex in the youth that we're serving. Why is it complex? Well, the biggest threat to health is the accumulation of negative stressors without the resources to cope. Okay? So this is important information for everybody in the room. If you're a young person, the best thing that you can do for yourself is to reduce your negative stressors. Okay, but that means you gotta know what they are. An essay is not a negative stressor. Let me just be clear about that. It is a stressor, but it's not a negative stressor. And I'll show you why in a minute, right? Negative stressors are toxic stressors, right? So, but the key is that if you're stacking multiple negative stressors and you don't have resources to cope with them. So who does that describe? Multiple negative stressors, no resources to cope. Which children? Which urban youth? Not all urban youth. Because you're gonna go to some, you go to Fremont and you can find some kids who are doing all right. They're pretty stable. And then you got other kids who are just really, really high need. So this describes the kids that are doing the worst in school, anywhere. Right? You go to Piedmont, and you find the kid that is doing the worst in school at Piedmont High, I guarantee you this is what's happening. They've got multiple negative stressors in their life, and they have got no resources to cope. They feel like nobody cares, they got nowhere to turn, so they're just carrying all this toxic stress in their body. And when you're carrying all that toxic stress in the body, it's a biological fact that you cannot study. This has nothing to do with race. This has nothing to do with class, has nothing to do with gender, right? It is a biological fact that if your body is under toxic stress, you cannot fully perform in school or any other aspect of your life. You can't have a deep, meaningful relationship with somebody because your body's carrying too much. Okay? And the reason for that is because of what toxic stress does to your allostatic load. Everybody in this room should be conversant in this term. You should know when your allostatic load is elevating. Okay? Because if you're aware of it, then you can respond differently. It won't dominate your life. Here's what allostatic load looks like in the body. This is straight out of a medical journal. Right? So I'm gonna save some teachers in the room right now. Okay? Because y'all are like, man, we're this all my students are gonna be like, man, I got toxic stress. You can't give me no essay, you're killing me. Right? So I'm gonna save y'all right now, right? So let me just be clear, all right? You have not once heard me say this stress is bad for you. There's a video right back there. You can go and check on the video, right? And I haven't said that because it's not true. Stress is a natural part of the human condition. Stress is actually good for your body. There's only one group of people on the planet that have no stress. Only one.
Dead
people. Okay? So don't worry, right? Your stress-free life is coming. Right? Every one of you will eventually have a stress-free life. Okay? It is guaranteed to every human being. So do not aim to have a stress-free life, okay? Because stress is good for you. I'll give you an example from my life, okay, of how a normal stress event goes down. The first time I asked my wife out, highly stressful event for me. Folks joke with my wife all the time. They're like, look, don't you ever like stress out because he's flying all over the world and he's staying in hotels and he's meeting all these single people? She goes, no. I said, why not? She says, because he has no game.
Wow.
Okay, so this is completely true, right? So my no game ass is over here trying to think about how I'm going to go talk to the most beautiful woman I ever seen in my life. And I'm literally standing in a corner saying shit to myself like, your mom says you're handsome. Your mom says you're handsome. Your mom says you're handsome. And I start going across the room to try to talk to her, and what's going on inside my chest? Right, it's pounding, right? That is what the medical field refers to as activity, right? A physiological response from my body to respond to the stress I'm feeling of having to go talk to this woman. Do I control that? No. This is important for you to understand. You do not control your SRS, your stress response system. It is the most dominant and sophisticated biological system in your body. It takes over everything. It takes over your memory. I did this talk in New Zealand. This is maybe 6-7 years ago. And I was one of the keynotes, and the other keynote was a neuroscientist. And it was him and another neuroscientist, both medical doctors, that imaged the brain when it undergoes stress. And they were telling us, you know, using the science, how stress affects your brain, right? And then they demonstrated it for us. So it's a man and a woman. The dude is up here on the mic, and he's explaining this stuff. And his partner, this woman, is also neuroscientist, is going through the audience with a mic. Okay? And she's coming up to people, and I'm not going to do it because I feel like, A, I'm not a neuroscientist, and B, that shit was just crazy to watch, so I don't want to see it again. But she's going around and she's going up to people and she's saying, she's holding the mic to their mouth and she's saying, what's your mother's name? And then, you know, of course everybody knows, well, not everybody, but most folks know their mother's name, right? So they kind of lucked out that everybody in the room knew their mother's name. So it's like, you know, Jenny and Kalana and she gets to the fifth one, right? She's walking up real casually and then all of a sudden she just goes right in that person's face, right? And she starts screaming at them. What's your mother's name? What's your mother's name? And she couldn't remember. Literally forgot her own mother's name. Because when that happened, right, all of the resources in her body went to the stress response mode, and she only had three options. Called FQ. Fight. Flight.
What? F. Oh, I just.
Fight, flight.
Freeze.
Okay. I never really understood freeze. Cast start letting off. Okay, I think they call that natural selection. But those are your three options. When your stress response system kicks in high order, you only have three choices. What did I not list off? I didn't list off remembering your mother's name. That is no longer an option. Your frontal cortex loses all of its resources. Everything goes back to your reptilian brain. And the reptilian brain has three options, and it's those three. You can fight, you can flee, or you can freeze. And that's it. So I'm going over to talk to my wife, and my heart is pounding because my SRS is kicking in, and my heart is pounding because when that happens, all these chemicals rush through your body, okay, to help you fight, or freeze. The one that you all will probably be most familiar with is something called adrenaline, right? That's what gets my heart pounding. Right? If you learn how to read the signs, you can tell when somebody is stressed because their jawline tightens up, their forearms tighten up, right? You are literally physically stronger under stress. Right? This is why if you ever been in a fight before, right, and you get socked up and you don't even realize, right? I mean, you after the fight, you like, God. Right? But during the fight, you don't realize because your adrenaline is just racing through your body. You are physically stronger, faster. Okay? Well, all those resources that are making you physically stronger and faster come from somewhere. And they come from other systems in your body that shut down and then relocate those resources so you can survive. Okay? So when I'm going across to talk to my wife, my heart is pounding because adrenaline is racing. The other, the one that the medical field is really concerned about right now is something, a chemical called cortisol. Because they've been able to directly link the overproduction of cortisol to the big unnatural killers in this society. Cancer, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, hypertension. Most folks over the course of the kind of medical, prevailing medical logic have believed that those things are caused by things like diet, smoking, drinking, lack of exercise. And it's true, all those contribute. But what they're finding is actually the biggest cause of cancer, type 2 diabetes, heart disease, and hypertension. Not lifestyle. That's the prevailing logic. And how convenient would that be? Because then it's your fucking fault. Right? It doesn't have anything to do with inequality in society. You chose to drink. You chose to smoke. You chose to live in housing projects. You chose to live around gunfire. It's your fault. And then we don't have to look at inequality, right? You just need to stop drinking and stop eating fatty foods. Now, those are contributors, right? But the biggest contributor to the unnatural killers, what the hell am I talking about? Toxic stress. Toxic stress is the biggest, because toxic stress is what overproduces cortisol. Let me be clear to you. Right? It's not the production of cortisol that causes those. It's the overproduction of cortisol. And the overproduction of cortisol happens when you are constantly exposed to toxic stress. That's not what we're talking about. I'm going across to talk to my wife. It's not toxic stress. It's just stress. So I get over there. I'm not going to tell you what I said. It's embarrassing. I'll tell you what she said. She said no. And then she said, but I'll take yours. Okay, so just let me put everybody in this room up on a little bit of game, because I didn't have no game. So I was like, oh, hell yeah, she took my number, dog, I'm good. I'm walking away, and the homies are like, dude, you stupid. Because apparently, when they take your, you laugh right now because you already know. This is wrong that you laughing at me. You don't even know me like that. So apparently for all us no game people, when they take your number, that's the brush off. Okay, so I just juiced and she took my number. So I'm walking away. Okay, what's going on inside my chest? Back to normal? Slowly. Right? And that slow slope down is what the medical field refers to as the recovery period. That is a natural stress event. That is actually good for your body. So teachers, when students come up to you and say, hey, I was in Andrade's talk and you're killing me with this 5-7 page essay. This is toxic stress. Right? They just go ahead and pull up the research and say, no, actually, I'm helping you because I'm giving you good stress. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about toxic stress, which looks like this in the body. I joke with high school teachers all the time about this one. Because for a high school kid, it's kind of like this. First period, second period, third period, fourth period. And what do you notice about the slope on this graph versus the slope on that one? Right, it's steep. On which side?
Both.
On both. And that's what kills you. Because it is a rapid influx of chemicals in your body and no recovery period. Because you're bouncing stressor to stressor to stressor. Right? And nothing is calming you down. Right? And that can eventually lead to this one. Right? All those little triangles you see, the medical field refers to those as deltas. Right? Those are unnatural shifts in what would normally be a fluid graph. So you can see this person starts kind of getting all over the place and there's little dips and curves and sideways winding. Okay? That can lead to the prolonged response. This is the person who is, you know that homie you got that is like always hyper, like always like just hypey as hell, always ready to go. Somebody just like bumps his Jordan. Right? That person, right, is here. Right? They're never de-escalating. Right? They're on high alert all the time. Their system is like threat, 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 threat. Okay? And eventually that person becomes this person. This is the person who has an inadequate response to stress. This is the person who can watch violence and muster no response. They're just deadpan. Because their stress system is so exhausted. It is so overworked. It's out of resources. And this is the kid that can't get out of bed. It's just literally physically done. Because their body is exhausted from all the stress. What this does to your body over time is what Arlene Geronimus at the University of Michigan Ann Arbor calls weathering. All right, this woman's research changed the field. Because what she did, and what I like about Arlene's work is that she's a medical doctor in public health, and she uses what I would call an ethnic studies approach to this research. Okay? When I say an ethnic studies approach, what I mean is that in ethnic studies, we tend to be critical of the larger academy and its desire to isolate individual causes. So the academy will say, well, I wonder how race operates, right? I wonder how poverty operates, or I wonder how patriarchy operates, or I wonder how homophobia operates. But the truth is, in the real world, it's not like that. In the real world, it's about the intersection of all those things, because they're all operating on you at the same time. So what she said is, I wonder what happens when you have multiple negative stressors interacting in somebody's life on a regular basis. So she did longitudinal studies of the lives of poor black women. And so she caught three of the big stressors. Right? She caught poverty, she caught racism, she caught patriarchy, all operating in one person's body at the same time. And what she found completely changed the conversation in the field. Because what she found is that these women's bodies were literally weathering from the inside out, literally deteriorating because of the stress. Now, I don't even pretend to understand all of Arlene's work, but what I can tell you is that if you want a really good summary of it, go online and get this issue of Miller McCune. Okay? And it's a few page article that kind of summarizes about two decades of her research and sort of where we're at right now with understanding that. And so basically what she found was, is kind of like, the way I describe weathering is like, It's like if you're poor and or a person of color in this society, you're born into a fight. You don't want to be in a fight, right? But the fight is on your doorstep the second you're born. Right? And the great thing about the human body is it will fight back. Right? You will fight to survive. Right? So if you've ever been in a fight before, I'm talking about like it ain't no getting out of it. Okay, like you in a corner and you gonna have to chuck them. Right? Where do you put your hands? What do you protect?
Head.
you protect the head, because that's where the quitters happen, right? So you come out, you get your hands up, and you try to get as much of your body as you can, right? But you're not fighting Mike Tyson. Because if you were fighting Mike Tyson, what would happen? Right. One, done. Right. Somebody over here said you get your ear bit. Right. So, but you're not fighting Tyson. Okay, you're fighting a pure pugilist. A true master of the sweet science. So you come out, you square up, you got your hands up, covering up your face. Where do they go to work? You go to work on the body, but that's all right because you work out at 24. And you got your little 2-pack, 4-pack, 6-pack, 8-pack, whatever pack you tell yourself you have. And so you can absorb the body blows. And if that's the truth about the human body, is incredibly resilient. So young people are getting all this stress, and they body blow after body blow, and they just keep coming. I'm going to keep coming to school. I'm going to keep moving my way through. I'm going to keep my head up. I'm going to keep pushing. Right? And you keep getting body blow, and body blow, and body blow, and body blow. And eventually, what happens to your hands?
They drop.
And then what happens?
You get knocked up. Out.
And then you get cancer, and then you get type 2 diabetes, and you get hypertension, and you get heart disease. That's how stress kills you. It's the silent, slow killer. It's operating inside your body. It is weathering your body over time. And the more stress, the more intense the storm. So most people at this point in this talk are here. Everyone with ideas, like, we need to get a drink right now. My mother's 86 years old, and she has recently discovered email, which means that I get updates on Jesus all the time. I know when he's risen, I know when he's dead, and I know when there's two sets of footprints in the sand, and there's only one. Apparently some of your mothers have discovered email, too. So I did this talk at Harvard a few years back. It was me and Arnie Duncan. Y'all know who Arnie Duncan is? He's Obama's appointee Secretary of Education. It was me and him. He went first, and then I went on second and explained why everything he said was wrong. And so Harvard makes a big deal of it. They do the video thing, and they put it up on YouTube. And so one of my brothers, he gets the YouTube link, and he emails it to my mom. And so my mom calls me up and says, yeah, your brother just sent me the link to your Harvard talk. I'm going to go on and check it out, and I'm going to call you back and tell you what I think. I was like, all right, cool, Mom. About an hour later, my mom calls me back. I said, well, what did you think? She says, I think you curse too much. The good thing about my mom is she does not text message. Okay? You don't know what that means. Don't worry about it. It's not really important. What is important is that we're not screwed at all. Actually, the medical research is crystal clear on what to do for young people that are experiencing toxic stress, to the point of it being conclusive. Right? Research isn't always conclusive. Sometimes research gives us insights, right? But it's not a clear conclusion. The research around response to toxic stress is actually fully conclusive. Study after study after study has shown the single biggest protective factor in the lives of a young person, in the life of a young person experiencing toxic stress is, anybody? Single biggest protective factor in the life of a young person experiencing toxic stress. What do you think it is? Not overall health, because if you got toxic stress, you ain't got overall health. Right? So it's exactly what you said, which is a caring adult. That's it. I ain't here with no rocket science. What the research reveals is the single biggest protective factor in the lives of a young person, in the lives of young people experiencing toxic stress, is a caring adult. Be careful now. Make sure you listen to what I'm saying and what I'm not saying. What I did not say is a licensed caring adult.
Come on now. Okay?
What I did not say is a licensed therapist, counselor, teacher. Okay? It's a caring adult. The research also shows that the more caring adults a young person has, the more likely they are able to successfully navigate through toxic stress. So This has to be the project of the ancestors. This is why virtually every single community in the history of the world has had a version of the African proverb, it takes a village to raise a child. Because we've known before all this medical research that the more adults that are show up in a young person's life and care for them at the moment of need, it's easy to care for a kid that shows up every day and is fully engaged. Because they make you feel like you're doing something. But can you muster courage, character, and commitment to care for the kid when they need you the most, when they're telling you to go fuck yourself, when they're telling you that they did not do your homework, when they don't show up to your class at all? Can you do it then? Because that's what the medical research says matters most. That's the moment. And the more adults they have, the more likely they successfully navigate through those moments. Okay? Why? Because the medical research has shown that there is a direct correlation between the number of caring adults a young person have and how much hope they have. And the only thing that the medical field has been able to measure that they showed mattered for a kid making it through hard times was hope. The medical field is literally now measuring hope because it's the only indicator they found that matters. Now, I like the word hope because I told you I'm an English teacher. And if you look the word hope up in the dictionary, you'll find it's both a noun and a verb, which means it's a dynamic word. It's a thing and an action. Okay? As I said, it's popping up more and more in the research. Charles Schneider, right, came up with something he calls hope theory. Right? He uses something he calls the children's hope scale. Okay? I use the children's hope scale in my high school classroom to measure hope levels when kids first come into our class and then to see how much is the work that we're doing with them actually changing their hope levels over time. Favorite definition of hope comes from a professor right across the way at UC Berkeley, a dude named Lynn Sine. He says, he defines hope as a sense of control of destiny. If you do not have a sense of control over your own destiny, you are de facto hopeless. And hopelessness is by definition paralysis. You're stuck. But if you have a sense that you control your own destiny, then obstacles become much easier to navigate. You'll find a way through because it is my destiny to get past this to the place I'm headed. But the more I've done this research, the more I realize I'm not into anything new. I'm simply revisiting the teachings of the ancestors. Now, the problem is that this country is profoundly ahistorical. We act as though history began in 1776. Most folks in this room don't know their true indigeneity. They don't know their original land. They don't know their original language. And because we don't know where we really come from, what we are in effect building in these schools is trees with strong trunks and strong branches and no roots. And when the storm comes, what happens to that tree? Goes down every time because it's top heavy. This is why the Ethnic Studies Project is so important. If you ain't got deep roots, if you don't know who you are, if you don't know where you come from, if you don't know your indigenous land, if you don't know your indigenous language, then when the storm comes, you'll lose your way. This is why we got so many young people out in the streets pulling triggers on each other. Because they don't even know who they are. They don't even understand where they come from. They don't understand when they look across the way and they see somebody looks exactly like them. That can't possibly be their enemy. But because we're not taught that in schools, because that is the first thing that was taken from us when we came into this country, we've lost our way. But if you go back, and I don't care who you are, I don't care if your people are from Europe, if your people are from the continent, if your people are from South America, if your people are from here. If you go back, if you trace back your indigenous ancestry, I guarantee you will find the same thing that I do when I track back my people. My people are from the Mayan and the Mexica. And the Mayans had a core principle that we taught all our children called Inlakesh. Now, Inlakesh became an increasingly popular conversation in education because of the work of some of my homies in Tucson in the Raza Studies program there. And Inlakesh is the story of the smoking mirror. And we would tell all our children that every living being you come across is a smoking mirror. That is not the question. The question, son, is whether or not you're going to muster the courage, character, and commitment to clear the smoke away. Because if I do, what will I see? See myself. It will be so much harder to pull a trigger when I can see myself in you. It will be so much harder for me to slang that rock to you if I can see myself. It would be so much harder for me to lay hands on you if I can see myself in you. It would be so much harder for me to call you a double G or a B or whatever if I can see myself in you. But if there's so much smoke between us that I can't even see your humanity, then you anything that I say you are. You're anything that's been filtered in my head to say you are. And it just flows out easily. That's the challenge. Can we go back to the teachings of the ancestors? And I promise you, wherever you come from, your people had in Lakesh. They called it something else in their own indigenous language. But they called it something else. And somehow, in this country, we've gotten so far away from the teachings of the ancestors. Then now my relationship to you is about a test score. Now my relationship to you is about your GPA. And if this institution upholds that paradigm, if it privileges completion over people, if it privileges numbers over humanity, then those are the young people we're putting out in that society, and don't be shocked, stunned, or amazed when they do dirt. Because we have institutionalized that in them. I have no responsibility to you as my classmate, because your grade has nothing to do with mine. And as long as that is what we institutionalize in school, that is what we will get from young people in the larger society, and I find it inexcusable that we blame them for that. They are simply replicating the institutional norms that we have put them through for 13 plus years. So if we are really leaders, if we are really teachers, then we don't just take that directive because that was what's handed down to us. We return to the original directive, which is the directive of the ancestors, to humanize our young people first. Then the grades take care of themselves. When I love myself, I'm going to learn. I'm going to do my homework. But when I don't, then homework is just work. I'm not really learning anything. How we try to do this in our community in East Alton is what we call critical hope. I call it the Holy Trinity of hope. The first of these is material hope. First and foremost, teachers in this room, just be badass at what you do. Just be the dopest literature teacher ever in the history of the planet. Be the dopest counselor dean ever, Luis. Ever, bro. Ever. But that won't be enough. You're going to have to supplement that with food, clothing, shelter. You got to pay attention to the kid that's coming to class always hungry. You got to pay attention to the kid that comes to class in the rain with a t-shirt on. And come out your new North Face jump coat from the, be real, it's from the outlet, it ain't from Macy's. Okay? Come out your North Face coat. Okay? Come out your umbrella. You be the one that catches the rain and let that young person catch some shelter. Pay attention to basic needs from the students. UCLA, this is something for the president to consider. UCLA realized, they surveyed, this is UCLA. You understand, this is UCLA. And UCLA found that close to 20% of its undergraduate population was food insecure. UCLA, 20% food insecure. So the leadership at UCLA started a food pantry for the whole university. So any young person that is ever hungry can just show up and get food. No questions asked. Okay? You can just be a fat ass, always hungry. You ain't actually hungry. You ain't actually food insecure. You just an eater. And it's okay, cool, you can have it. Right? No questions asked. No fucking hoops to jump through. No forms to fill out. No, what's your social security number? No, are you documented? No, what's your California driver's license? No, do you have financial aid? You hungry, we feed.
Yes.
Right. That's what we do. That's the ancestors. So best believe it, UCLA has a 20% food insecure population. College of Alameda got numbers. There's cats in this room that's like, Luis, thank you for the turkey and for the ham extra sandwich that I got. Stuff like that matters, y'all. It matters if you're really going to ask students to focus on homework. Okay? Got to feed them, got to protect them. And when we do this, we pay attention to the most pressing needs. Okay? We close the gap between what students actually need and what we offer them. Okay? Here's the part that makes me mad about even talking about this, is that we've known this since 1943. Maslow releases the hierarchy of needs in 1943. This is widely agreed upon across fields. For 60 years, this is how I know schools are not research-based. This is how I know that schools ignore the data. This is 6 decades of agreement in the research field that this is the pathway. The most successful students are at the pinnacle. Self-actualization. The most successful students self-actualize. The beauty of Maslow's research is it actually shows the pathway to self-actualization. First and foremost, you must have your basic needs met. Food, clothing, shelter, safety. Let me be clear about safety. I'm not just talking about physical safety. I'm talking about spiritual safety, emotional safety, sexual safety, all forms of safety. So a student can be physically safe, right? But emotionally stressed out. So all forms of safety. If you get that right, then the student can start to find some stability in the next tier, love and belonging. Do they feel a sense of love and belonging on this campus? And how do you know? What is your data that shows that students at the College of Alameda feel loved, feel a sense of belonging when they're on this campus? And they don't. Well then, you ain't gonna get this. That is a medical fact. And you can do all the education programming you want. Right? Any medical doctor will tell you, if a student does not feel a sense of love and belonging, they cannot self-actualize over time. They can have moments. Right? They can have a good class, they can have a good semester, but over time, they can't hold it up there because this drags them back down. If you get this right, okay, then you gotta have ethnic studies. You gotta have esteem. Young people have to be taught to love themselves. They have to be taught how valuable they are. They have to be taught how beautiful they are. But what's happening with our young people is they're taught to hate themselves. Hate their hair texture, hate their skin color, hate the language they speak. As long as that happens, they can't self-actualize. And let me just be clear. White folks need ethnic studies too. And people think of the ethnic studies project as a project for people of color. No. White folks need ethnic studies too, need to understand their own indigenous origins. You are not American unless you are indigenous, Western, native. You are not American. Your people are from somewhere else. And if you don't understand those people, if you don't understand that language and that land, you can't really love yourself. This country is a manufactured nation state. It is a nation state that is built on top of other civilizations. Okay? I should have started this talk by acknowledging the Ohlone and asking for their permission, the ancestors' permission from the Ohlone to speak today. Okay? So I'm remiss for that. I acknowledge my indigenous ancestors and I beg your forgiveness. Right? And I ask now for permission to continue from my Ohlone ancestors. We are on top of another civilization right now. You gonna teach California history, you ain't gonna teach that? Shit, that ain't California history. Second is Socratic. To have a Socratic sensibility, it's a term I borrow from Cornel West. Okay? And this is the importance of not just saying the sermon, but showing this. Young people don't wanna hear any more sermons. They wanna see sermons. They want to see people who live what they say. But we quick to lecture young people. We quick to tell them what to do, but we don't live our lives that way. So they turn the volume down. And, well, you ain't living right. How you going to tell me to live right? You don't know who you are. How you going to tell me who I need to be? Right? So it starts with self. Right? Do we live the sermon that we preach? For me, this is the gap between being liked and being loved. And what I find is that so many people that are working in our communities are outsiders to our community. And when you're an outsider to a place, you tend to be conflict averse. Right? You're like Switzerland. You don't want beef with nobody. You just try to keep it cool with everybody. And the problem is that no one in this room has ever had their life changed by someone they liked. The only people that have fundamentally changed your life are people that you have loved and that loved you. And so the problem is that we got so many folks working with our young people that ain't to be liked because they don't want to deal with love. And you see, the problem with love in this country is that we have a Pollyannish definition of love. It's all based on The Notebook. You guys seen The Notebook before? Yeah. That's love, right? And if it ain't that, then it ain't love. So we've come to believe in this country that love is the absence of conflict. And if we got conflict, we must not really love each other. No. Love is the presence of conflict with the courage, character, and commitment to find your way through. That is love. And I'll prove it to you. Show of hands, how many of you in here have ever had a personal relationship go bad? Mm-hmm. I did this talk in Texas. You can imagine how I go over in Texas. It's all right, I was in Austin, which isn't really Texas. And it was like all of Austin Unified, all the teachers from the whole district, almost 2,000 people. And I asked that question, 1,999 people raised their hand, one person lied. There was mics set up down the row from the Q&A, and this one woman is sitting right on the row. She leans over, grabs a mic, and goes, "Yeah." And he's right there. That was precisely my response. I was like, "Go ahead, this would be way more interesting than you had to say." Some trauma, and here it comes. Now I'm talking about the one where you got your heart stomped out. I'm talking about the one that made you fundamentally doubt love. That one. After you got crushed, who paid for your pain? Some of y'all apparently are pretty close to it because they just shouting stuff out. The next one, everybody.
We have a term for it in our society. Right? We call it the rebound.
And the reason for that is because love is perhaps the highest risk human behavior. Because to be truly in love, I'm talking about Tupac's unconditional love. Right? I'm going to love you no matter what. You are at risk all the time. Your heart is out in your chest, open to be stomped out. And if you work in communities that are highly traumatized, as they say, hurt people, hurt people. So you coming up, right, working with hurt people that are going to hurt people, and you come up and you got your heart out in your chest, what's going to happen? You're going to get hurt. That's not the question. The question is whether or not after you get hurt, are you going to come back in unconditionally? Or are you going to keep your arm up and start keeping young people at a distance because you don't want to get hurt again? This ultimately is the challenge that Socrates put out there for us. Now, if you are currently in a relationship that has lasted, it is because you came into that relationship with your arm out. Because you hurt. So you ain't just come back in a relationship like, "I know we just met, I think we should probably just get married right now." You coming back in that relationship at arm's length because you don't want to get hurt like that again. And if that relationship has lasted, it's because that person gently pushed your arm down and said, "That's all right. That ain't me. And I know you got some baggage, and that's okay. We can go through it one piece at a time until we empty out that baggage." And then 6 months later, they said, "By the way, I got some baggage too. Can we get the line out?" I'm just trying to keep it real. So, love is not going to be the absence of conflict. We're really going to love these babies. It's going to be some beef sometimes. We're going to have to really go through it with them sometimes. They're going to be hurting. They're going to hurt us. And we got to show back up the next day, put your heart back on its chest, ready to get stomped out all over again. That is what Pac means when he talks about unconditional love. And that, y'all, is why teachers drink. No lies between us. Third is audacious hope. Lisa Delpit wrote many books. My favorite is my favorite just because of the title. She wrote a book called Other People's Children. And she says, one of the problems that we got in education is that so many of the educators see the children as other people's children. And other people's children can fail. Other people's children can be suspended. Other people's children can be expelled. Other people's children can be locked up in juvie to get some tough love. But what if it's your son? What if it's your daughter? How many different angles would you work? How many different battles would you fight? can we see all these babies as ours? Because as long as they're other people's children, we'll always come up short. Now, the way we try to do this is by thinking about, look, the reality is that the shooting, the police brutality, the poverty, the xenophobia, all those, they're not going to end tonight. So they're going to come to your classroom, teachers. It's going to show up. So you got to be aware of the meta ecosystem. You got to be aware of how those things are affecting students because they're carrying it in their bodies. And then you got to get to work on your micro ecosystem. Control what you can control. Dig where you stand. No master gardener blames the seed for not growing. They look at themselves instead and say, how do I need to adjust this soil to meet the needs of this particular seed in this particular environment? The best description I've heard of this actually comes from a medical doctor, a woman named Camera Jones, who's a medical doctor at Columbia University in New York. She wrote an article for a medical journal called The Gardener's Tale. She tells this story about how she had just been hired at Columbia, and her husband bought a house, and they're walking up the stairs of the house, and they get to the front door, and she looks to the right, and there's a window, and underneath the window is a flower box. And she turns to her husband and says, that should be our first project, because that's going to be the first thing that everybody sees when they come visit us. And her husband, like any smart partner, says back,
yes,
dear. That's a great idea. So that weekend, they go to the gardening store. And she buys a bag of soil and a packet of flower seeds. And she comes back up to the flower box. And as she leans in, she's getting ready to put the soil in. And she realizes there's a partition splitting the box in half. And on one side, there's already soil. So she takes the fresh soil and empties it into the empty side. And then she takes the seeds. And she splits the packet in half. And she needs half the seeds into one side and half the seeds into the other. She says, what happened next was the most important medical discovery of my career. Because on the side where the fresh soil was, all the seeds grew. Full height, vibrant colors, made space for each other in the box. But on the other side, she said, I realized that soil was old, and it was rocky, and it was devoid of key nutrients. And on that side, only a few of the seeds grew. And they only grew to middling height, and they crowded each other in the box with a few resources that were available. She says, what I realized in that moment is how much place matters. That's how much you, educators, matter. You cannot stop the homicide today. You cannot stop the poverty today. You cannot stop the self-hate today. But you can change the soil where you educate those children. You can dig differently. And what we know from the research and practice is that matters. But to do that in a way, to believe that every child that comes across your path is your child, you better be audacious. You better not let this institution crush your hope. You better not let the state crush your hope. You better keep believing that you can reach every child that comes to you, that you can love every child that comes to you. And the truth is, you won't. In 22 years of doing this work in my community, I have never had a perfect year. I have never had a perfect semester. I have never had a perfect marking period. I have never had a perfect month. I have never had a perfect week. I have never had a perfect day. I have never had a perfect class period, ever. But I wake up every day expecting to, knowing that I won't. And to do that for 20 plus years, you better be audacious. No matter what initiative comes down, you've got to keep believing that what you do matters, that how you change that soil matters. And it won't always matter in the way that they're measuring it, but it does matter. And I'll prove it to you. Perhaps the best example that I can end with of what I mean by critical hope comes from a story that this woman told. And she tells the story during an interview with Dave Chappelle. And so you can kind of do that math, right? Maya Angelou, Dave Chappelle, that's an interesting interview. But, you know, interesting interviews make for interesting interviews. I have up next to it my colleague Sean Jenright's book, who you should add him to your list for next year, Luis. Sean wrote this book called Black Youth Rising, and the reason I actually have his book up here is because of the subtitle, which you probably can't read from where you're sitting. In the subtitle, he uses the term radical healing. And I believe that is what the most effective teachers do. They're not healers. They're radical healers. Because the conditions that we're talking about are radical. And radical conditions demand a radical response. Now, I'm going to end this talk by playing this interview that Maya did with Dave Chappelle, because I think it models precisely what I mean by critical hope.
Until was doing this movie, Poetic Justice, and he asked, would I come out to Los Angeles and do a cameo? I walked out of my trailer that morning, and there was one young man cursing like you could see the blue come out of his mouth. And then he and another fellow, they were at each other's throats. They had each other's clothes. So I went up to one young man and I said to him, excuse me, may I speak to you? He said, I wouldn't give, I said, I'm Santa. But may I speak to you for a minute? He said, if these little, I said, uh-huh. I've heard that before. But do you know how important you are? Do you know that our people snapped, lay spoon fashion in the filthy acts of slave ships, in their own and in each other's excrement and urine and menstrual flow, so that you can live 200 years later? Do you know that? Do you know that our people stood on auction blocks so that you could live? Is it as noble as when the last time anyone told you how important you are? And he started to, the tears started to come out. I had no Kleenex or anything, so I just wiped his face with my hands and talked to him. And Miss Janet Johnson came. She says, Angelo, I don't believe you actually talked to Tupac Shakur. So I didn't know Tupac Shakur. I didn't know Six Pack. Because it, in my life and my age group, you understand? It just didn't, I didn't know that. Tupac's mother told me about that. She said her son had called her right after I had spoken to him. And she wanted to thank me. She said, you may have saved his life. And I thank you, Dr. Angelo.
In that one story, she painted a more human picture of him than the entire media did during his career, you know. People were afraid of Tupac. The media made him like he was a scary thing, and she talks about him like he was a young man in a confusing and difficult situation. And that's kind of what I like about Dr. Angelo, because I know I'm not perfect and whatever, but it's something that she can look at me and she can kind of put the picture together. She knows I'm just a dude trying to figure it out.
Each of us has a chance to be somebody. And it's my delight that you would ask for me so that I can have the pleasure, the joy, the thrill of talking to you so that I can be somebody.
For me, that's master pedagogy. That's master teaching. Being able to find the lesson inside the lesson when the student needs it most. But why does it matter? Well, Maya intervenes in Pac's life circa 1991. She's on the movie set of Poetic Justice. Poetic Justice comes out in 1991. Okay. Now, if you study Tupac as an artist, as I do, what you will find is the period between 1991 and 1996 was the most artistically productive period of Tupac's life. He wrote so much during those 5 years that Tupac's own mother says she bought him. And she says, by intervening in his life on that day, you saved his life. And so because Maya saves his life on that day by intervening, she buys him 5 more years before he's gunned down in the streets of Las Vegas. And those 5 years were so productive, Tupac wrote so much during that period, they couldn't publish it all. This is why he has album after album after album coming out after he's murdered. One of those albums that was written during that period was released in 2003. It's an album called Resurrection. In 2009, my homie snaps this photo all the way across the world in Kathmandu. It is a picture of three brothers standing in front of one of the largest Buddhist shrines in the world. The oldest brother is in the middle, and he is turned to the right, and he is consoling the middle brother, whose hand is on his head because he is weeping. The baby brother on the left is watching, learning empathy. What you might not catch about this photo is the shirt that the oldest brother is wearing. That is the album shirt from Resurrection. That is why your work matters so much. It won't always show up in completion rates. It won't always show up in GPA. But when we change young people's lives, it ripples across ocean. But let me be clear, this is why, this picture is why it is so important that we invest in our Tupacs, that we invest in the kid who is the most resistant. Because that kid will write the rose that grew from concrete. That kid will be the one that is most skilled at communicating back to other kids that need it most. He's the one, she's the one that they will listen to at their lowest moment. That is why investing in them is so important. Because the Tupacs will come back to the concrete. The Tupacs will put themselves back down in the crack and support that next generation of roses that's coming up in ways that very few other people will. Now, if there is any way that we can support you on this journey, do not hesitate to reach out. If you are doing work across the bay, right, or excuse me, across the tunnel, right, if you're doing work across the bay, I can't help you. Right, but if you're doing work across the tunnel in the town, right, do not hesitate to reach out if we can partner or support that work anyway. Thank you.
Left us a lot to think about today, but I have just a couple comments that resonated with me from hearing him speak today, both to educators and to students. Two things that really stood out to me was, one, I kind of see this as a challenge for our institution, and also as a call for unity, right? So on one end, as educators, we got to think about, like he said earlier, how we laid out all of our inequities on the table. Are we unified right now to actually do something to address those inequities on the table? So again, I'm hoping that today either may have served as a reminder or maybe it's a motivating factor for our educators in this room to come together and let's roll up our sleeves and get down to some work when it comes to equity. Because really, once we leave this room, we're gonna have a choice, right? You're either gonna think about this for the next half hour to an hour and forget about it, or we're gonna actually utilize the inspiration we gained from today to do some meaningful work moving forward with it, right? So for the students, it's also a challenge and a call for unity, right? For students, he talked about the importance of being able to identify your negative stressors, right? Being able to identify your negative stressors so that you can overcome those negative stressors. And realize that it's also important for students to unify together. You know, not only with the faculty, staff, and administrators, but with each other. That as students, you can help each other overcome a lot of the things that you're dealing with to be here today. Okay, so with that being said, I really hope this is, again, a driving factor for us to move forward together as a community and as a family. And let's give it up one last time for Dr. Jeff Duncan-Andrade.